Thank you very much for this kind introduction. Also, well, my only comment is, if I'm one of the most important thinkers in the world today, what a shitty world this is. Probably if a guy like me comes. Okay, sorry.
Okay, I correct myself.
Okay. The legend has it that in 1633, Galileo Galilei muttered his famous "Eppur si muove," and yet it moves, after recanting before the Inquisition, renouncing his theory that the earth moves around the sun. He was not tortured. It was enough to take him on a tour and show him the torturing devices. There is no contemporary evidence that Galileo effectively said this phrase. Today, the phrase is used to indicate that although someone who possesses true knowledge is forced to renounce it, this does not stop it from being true. But I claim that what makes this phrase so interesting is that it can also be used in the exactly opposite way, to assert a truth of something which is literally not true. In this sense, a materialist can say that although he knows that there is no God, the idea of a God nonetheless moves him. Beyond the fiction of reality, there is the reality of the fiction. Freud's own "Eppur si muove" was the saying of his teacher Charcot, which Freud often repeated. La théorie c'est bon, mais ça n'empêche pas d'exister. Theory is good, but it doesn't prevent facts which do not fit it to exist. And it goes without saying that the same ambiguity holds to it. It shouldn't be reduced to simple empiricism. You know, this idea that you philosophers may talk whatever you want, but in reality things persist. Again, what is much more interesting, especially from today's perspective, where we allegedly live in a post-ideological era, which of course means that we are as deep in ideology as I claim humanity never was in its entire ideology, to return to Marx and reread his topic of commodity fetishism. I'm sorry if I will be repeating today some of the things that maybe some of you already know from my works, but I just want in a clear way to develop a certain line, namely the commodity fetishism of Marx precisely fits this reality of the fiction. Read Marx closely, and here you will see how actual he is. The point of his theory of commodity fetishism is not we people who are engaged in capitalist production, we have wrong, illusory ideas about reality. Like, you know, when Marx says in Capital, sie wissen das nicht, aber sie tun es. This is not the empirical vulgarity of they don't know what they are doing, but they are doing it. It's, I claim, if you look, read Marx closely, you will see that he means exactly the opposite. What he means is that we may know how things truly are, but what we do not know is that in spite of our knowledge, we follow illusions which we know that are not true in our reality. Social activity, commodity exchange, and so on and so on. So you see the beauty that two levels are not enough. It's not simply what things really are and the way we perceive or misperceive them. There is the way things really are, there is the way things appear to us, and now comes the beauty, there is the way things objectively appear to us, even if we do not know how they appear to us. This idea of objective appearance. So here, I think, is the point of this, one of the points of this, how we should use this "Eppur si muove." You may be well aware that it's not true, but "Eppur si muove." You know, like the most stupid example. If I ask you, do you believe in Santa Claus? Of course you don't believe. I ask your children, they will say, I'm not stupid. I pretend to believe not to deceive the parents and to get the presents and so on. So nobody believes and pur si muove. Billions of dollars are spent and so on.